Or record it in some way, and that's basically how it came about.
Right. You say you're interested in the images, Tommy, but now I could be wrong, but in those days, 100 years back, there weren't too many professional photographers about. People then were taking pictures of families, events, social events. How come that these photographers turned out some of the best pictures you've ever seen? And the quality of the pictures as well.
Yeah.
And remember, when a good amount of this stuff wasn't just taken for newspapers and things like so, we're not going to take for propaganda, so they have to know what we're about.
That's correct, yeah. The ordinary soldier wasn't allowed to carry a camera because they were taking images of dead comrades and explosions, and that was sent back to get developed. It was shown the war in a very poor light. So what the government done, they said, right, we'll appoint photographers. Now, as you say, you're right, there were wedding photographers and portrait photographers, and they went over here to take these photographs. And the images that they recorded with the gear that they had, as you can see some of the, it was, for 100 years ago and the equipment, the quality was excellent. And this is really the crux of what we were doing, because we actually had in the club one night, we set up a photograph, a modern day photograph in one of the competitions, and a photograph, black and white photograph from the trenches, and the only three in the day we couldn't have told which period the photograph was taken.
Yeah, but you say the only soldier wasn't allowed to carry a camera. Surely this is a camera that the portly soldier carried away with him during that time.
This is what they call a pocket vest, pocket camera. And these were private, bought by the soldiers themselves. He kept them. And they're actually illegal, they weren't allowed to use them, but I was telling somebody not to do something, they did. And this was the most popular type of camera for the ordinary soldier that was taken on a face of
footage. The quality of this wouldn't be as good as the quality of this. This would have been an official German used and British used camera of the day.
Mm-hmm.
A plate camera.
Yeah, because you have the plate, which give you a bigger negative, and as you know yourself, the bigger the negative, the better the image. But these wee lads here record a great image as well, you know.
When you talk about the plate camera, after the photographer took the picture, what did he do with it? How did he get it developed? Where did he go? How did he get there with the bombs going on?
Well, a lot of them were actually developed on set in dark rooms on the front line.
You're talking about, a tent?
Yeah, that type of thing, yeah.
How did you come to start this project in the first place? The start, how did it start?
Actually, I had started, again, go back to the quality of these photographs. And I was talking with Tom Ferrell one night and I said, Tom, you know, I can't get over the quality of these. I was really fascinated. And sort of sat down and started to talk, you know, what would the next step would be. So we threw ideas back and forth to each other, and Tom suggested that we look into it more closely and see what comes out. And that's what we've done. We started the ball rolling and it escalated till we're here today.
Tommy, this is the thing I'm pretty sure of during the past, these photographers, now, were they money coming, were they shipped in, were they shipped out? They certainly didn't go on the front line and jump over the wire to the rest of the soldiers. How did they get their pictures?
Well, you're right what you say, Herbie, and as I said earlier on, the government actually employed these guys and lasses to go and take these photographs. So to make sure that they were doing what they were told and they were taking the photographs that the government at the time wanted to see, they were actually escorted in, taken, the photographs taken, and escorted out again. So the government got exactly what they wanted, propaganda photographs.
Yeah, but I mean, these photographers, tell me, money wouldn't have paid them for what they were doing. Why were they there?
Well, they must have had a sense of adventure as well, Harry. You know, photographers...
But, sorry, did they not know what they were walking into?
I would doubt. They wouldn't have been... they wouldn't have realised quite exactly what they were walking into. It was hell on earth. But you know, photographers, they're a hard party or a hard... You'd do anything for a photograph.
Right.
You know, as you know yourself. And this is the spirit of photography carried on through you.
But tell me, this project there, a lot of young people today don't know anything about the First World War. How do you intend to let them know through your exhibition of what happened 100 years back?
Well, we have 70 to 100 images from the First World War, and some of them are very graphic. There's nothing romantic about it. It is black and white, pure war. And I think that everybody should know, see this exhibition. They said it was a war that would end all wars, but as you know, it didn't. But if young people can grasp how horrible war is, maybe future generations will might do away with it. So I think it's very important that this is shown to them.
Thank you.